Good evening.
Good evening.
I guess you're there. Good evening. It is good to see each one of you here and to look across, look at all your faces. Represents people that are important to the lives of four individuals up here. And you're here to celebrate with them this journey that they have, that they are kind of, in some ways, they're bringing to a close, in other ways, they're starting. Graduation doesn't necessarily mean an ending. It means you're graduating and you're moving on, in a sense, from this point to the next. So it's an exciting time to celebrate that together. And so it's good to have each of you here participating with us in that. In a little bit, I'll invite the high school chorus to come up. Why don't you just stand with me? We'll have kind of an opening prayer here and invite the Lord to join us, and then we'll invite the high school chorus to come up. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this evening, beautiful evening, Lord, that you blessed us with. Lord, I thank you for each one of these students, Lord, that are now moving on and have attained these this point in life, you might say. Lord, I thank you for the effort and the work that they have put into that, and just bless our time here as we celebrate this milestone and as we participate together in that. And we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. High school's class does. Thank you, High School Chorus. The last song is a song with a question. And thank the Lord there's an answer at the end of that, that He is worthy. Praise the Lord for that. I'd like to introduce the salutatorian address and the valedictorian address. The salutatorian address will be given by Mackenzie Slaybaugh, and she has a GPA of 3.80. And then following her address, the valedictorian address by Jonathan Schrock with a GPA of 3.98. Mackenzie?
On behalf of the class of 2022, I would like to welcome you all and say thank you for being here. It means a lot. I would especially like to thank my parents, teachers, family, and friends who have influenced me in many different ways. As I look forward to graduating from school, I'm sad to be ending this chapter in my life, but I'm grateful for the memories that I will have to look back on. One of the memories I'm sure none of our class will forget is the day we were in eighth grade playing softball. Jordan was up to bat, and he hit the ball towards second base where Katrina was, and the ball bounced up and hit her right above her one eye. Right then, we were done playing softball, and Mr. Yoder told one of us to go to Miss Carla and tell her to call 911. So Becca went running into the classroom, and as she was running there, Miss Carla heard her and was wondering why somebody was running in the hall, and right then, she was like, whoever it is, she's gonna give them a behavior demerit. But obviously, we all know she forgot that when Becca got to her. It ended up, Katrina was more in shock than anything. Some of my favorite memories from school, though, were Bible quizzing, choir fest, and our Spanish class trip. I enjoyed Bible quizzing because I got to make new friends and compete against other schools. And it was cool to get to learn to know new people who have memorized the same scriptures that I have. Choir Fest was also a huge highlight for me because it was so much fun to hear how the songs we had sung as an individual choir sounded with 100 or so students. In March, over our spring break, our Spanish class was privileged to go to the DR. I enjoyed being immersed in the culture and seeing how warm and welcoming their culture truly is. It made me realize how we as Americans are. We so often are ungrateful and just not as friendly as they are. They made me also realize that they are much happier. We thought it was terrible that we didn't have water for a few days. We think we need it to survive. While we were there, the water was off for a few days due to how much it had been raining. We made it just fine without it, but we were much more grateful for it when it did come back on. As I'm sure you all have noticed by now, I am the only girl graduating tonight. To be honest, I never really knew how to answer the question when people ask me how it is to be the only girl in my class. It has been good for me. It has taught me many different things, especially how to learn to get to know people that are not in your class. There have definitely been times when I wished there was another girl, but as far as grad planning, it was much easier because we didn't have as many opinions, and so it's hard to reach an agreement on things. I would like to encourage you all with Hebrews 12, verses 1 to 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw up everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with patience, let us run with perseverance, the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. I love these verses because it shows us how easy and straightforward it is of what our goal should be here on this earth as Christians. What a good reminder to set our eyes on Jesus, and he will help us run the race he has for us. As we all look to the future of our lives, may we all remember that we are here to do work for God's kingdom. I hope you leave here knowing what your goal should be here on this earth.
be thanked. You know who you are. Thank you. We, the class of 2022, are here tonight to celebrate our years in school and anticipate the future, theoretically at least. Our class has been unconventional in some areas. In the past, the classes above us have fit the 7th to 12th grade courses into 5 years and graduated after 3 years of high school. We're the first class to have the full 12 years after kindergarten, although Jordan's the only one who's actually been here for all of them. Our unusual transition and 2 years of being the oldest class at Plainview have given us plenty of opportunity to end the traditions of those gone before us. I'm sorry to report, or perhaps not so sorry, that Bolts and Pails, Sing in the Side Room, and the Shindig Midnight Dip into the Pool have been unceremoniously discontinued at some point or another. Unfortunately, or fortunately, based on your view, even softball seems to have fallen into this category. Don't worry, we haven't ended all the traditions. The blue elephant still hangs on the president's flag. These customs don't seem very consequential. What happens when we get into the proverbial real world? Choosing whether to follow our peers will carry more weight than choosing whether to eat the grad meal in a tent of streamers behind the backboard. Classmates, I encourage you to be intentional about which traditions you carry on and which you forget. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Speaking of traditions, we've been blessed more than we realize, I suspect. Not many students have what we have. A school founded around the Bible, parents willing to sacrifice to send us here, and teachers who care deeply about what they teach and why they teach it. I'm very thankful for all the work our teachers have put in for us. Ms. Beachy, thank you for giving us plenty of exciting activities and projects. I was never taught by Mrs. Bethany, but thank you anyway. Ms. Troyer, thank you for keeping our cursive letters within a 3/4 millimeter of the line, even if my cursive is about unreadable at this point. Mr. Yutzi, thank you for the airplane throwing contest. Mrs. Schenk, for the terrarium, where we could examine noble insects fulfilling their short and gloomy lives. Mr. Yoder, for dissecting that smelly fish in science class. Ms. Carla, for giving us proper speech training, thereby removing my excuses for the speech's problems. Ms. Yoder, for teaching us that one can go for years without wearing the same outfit twice. Mr. Gingrich, for giving us half wrongs when we deserved whole wrongs. Ms. Chupp, for definitely keeping us on topic and definitely not just letting us chat for most of the class period. And last but not least, Mr. Lance, for bland classes made interesting, rabbit trails, awful puns, and overall being the best. Also, thank you, Jordan, for your sense of humor and willingness to do all the talking in public so I don't have to. Kinsey, for organizing grad and getting the rest of us to actually do something. And Josh, for never letting things get boring and keeping our egos in our place in the athletic activities. I wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan and Kinsey, for that. Very well done. At this point, I'd like to welcome Matt Yutzi for the commencement address. He's the pastor in the community here. Matt?
Good evening and welcome to all of you. To Jonathan, Jordan, Mackenzie, and Josh, congratulations. You have worked hard to be here. You've invested a lot of time and effort to arrive at the ceremony this evening. I would like to point out a bit of a difference, though. When Mr. Gingrich introduced me, there was one thing that he didn't say that he did when he introduced Jonathan and Kinsey. That was your GPA. I'm glad he didn't say what mine was, because it would not have attained to what yours are. Did you know that it's been roughly 4,440 days since you started kindergarten? And that's equal to roughly 106,560 hours. I know that not all of that time was spent here at school, but if you stop and think about that, that's a long time. That's a very long time. A lot of things have changed since then, but you have pressed on to this evening. Some of you, I think, have had to press harder than others. But I'd like to encourage you that the perseverance that you showed to come here tonight will continue to pay off as you go from here. Kinsey, you made the comment that you were the only girl, and so there were not that many opinions. The class that I graduated in, there were 10 girls. It's a wonder that we were able to graduate, but we did get it done. I think the two fellows in that class have helped to balance out the 10 girls. I'd like to encourage you, continue to learn with humility as you journey on in life. You know, your class is special to me, and the reason it's special, you were the ones that both began and ended my formal teaching career. Take from that what you will. Your class motto is learn from yesterday, live for today, and hope for tomorrow. And that is a quote that is attributed to Albert Einstein. And I just heard a little bit of rumblings through the grapevine that one of the pros to that quote was there's not a lot of letters to cut out. And that's maybe one reason why that quote was chosen. But anyhow, I'd like to modify that just a little bit and say learn from the past, live in the present, and plan for the future. The title of my speech tonight is Learn, Live, and Plan. And the first thing I want to do is share with you several things that I have learned while attending the same school that you did. So in first grade, I learned how to read. And I had an excellent teacher. Actually, all of my teachers were excellent, and there's quite a few of you that are here tonight. I want to publicly thank you. I will be calling out just a few of you, and it'll be complimentary, so rest easy. But in first grade, I was taught to read. But there's one other thing that I was taught as well, and that was that you should always have a sharp pencil in your desk. And you know what the consequence was if you didn't have a sharp pencil? We had our ears pinched, if I remember correctly. The teacher would come around and check our pencils, and if they weren't sharp, she would pinch our ear. And I suspect that one of the reasons for that was she wanted us to be prepared for when the next class starts. That way we don't have to scramble around and try to sharpen our pencils yet. And also I think it was an effort to help us, to help our writing be neat. Now, some of you already alluded to the fact that yours isn't neat anymore. So maybe you need to go back to third and fourth grade and sit under Miss Chorter's tutelage for a little bit. But that's the next teacher that I want to talk about. My third and fourth grade teacher taught me the importance of obedience and discipline. During the last week of school, like you just experienced, excitement was running high in our classroom. We were cleaning out our desks, putting books back on the shelf, and I discovered that if I put my hands into that empty desk and move them up and down, there is a noise that is made by doing that. And my teacher did not appreciate that noise as much as I did, and she told me to quit, and I stopped. But a couple minutes later, I hope without thinking about it, I started doing that again. And so Ms. Chorter kindly dismissed the rest of the class, told them that they can go outside and have some free time. And then she told me that, okay, I want you to go ahead and keep making that noise for approximately 5 minutes or so. You know what? It wasn't near as much fun to do it all by myself as it was when there was a classroom there to enjoy those sounds with me. Ms. Chorter, I want to publicly thank you for teaching me about discipline and obedience. And not only discipline, but creative discipline. It's something that I have tried to use for myself and for my children for the last 35 years. So thank you. It's a lesson that I'll remember as long as my memory serves me well. My fifth and sixth grade teacher taught me the power of apology. He was a teacher who expected a good effort from his students, and he took measures to help us along when he perceived that we might be slacking. I had no problem giving 100% when recess time came, but I had a bit more of a problem giving my best on the academic side of things. And I imagine most of you boys, most of you fellows understand what that's all about. But one day something happened at recess, and my temperature went up quite a bit. And a day or so later, my teacher came to me and we talked about it. And he apologized to me, even though I was the one that was in the wrong, more in the wrong anyhow. He apologized to me. And that has stuck with me all these years. And you know, many years later, I had the opportunity, or I took the opportunity and the privilege to call him on my cell phone and apologize for some of my actions in his classroom. He listened quietly, let me say what I needed to say, and then he kindly told me that he forgave me. No ill will at all. And so tonight, I want to publicly thank Mr. Chorter for teaching me the power of apology and forgiveness. It was a lesson that I needed to learn, and it was a lesson that he taught well. What I want you to notice, the things that I have mentioned about my teachers, there's not a lot that I said about math, English, and arithmetic, but more about character. And you know what, to all of you teachers here tonight, I'd encourage you, keep building character in your students. Those are the things that they will remember many years down the road. At this time, I also want to share some things that the graduating class, I text them and ask them, what are some things that you learned at school? And so I want to take just a bit of time and share those with you this evening as well. Jonathan said, I've learned that a few subjects that I had first doubted would ever be useful actually can be useful outside of school. Jonathan, I agree wholeheartedly with that. When I was in school, I thought, you know what, especially English grammar, what good will it do? But you know what, it is good to pay attention to those things. Mackenzie said, sometimes the subjects you think you don't like can become some of your favorites. And I guess that the teacher has a lot to do with that. Maybe not all, but quite a lot. Josh said, school is a lot more enjoyable when I buckle down and stay on top of my work and don't get behind. And you know what, Josh? That's life. That's life. Don't let things pile up. Jordan, my actions are important and they affect those around me. You know what? I think you as a class, I think you've learned well. Keep continue to learning. Don't look at this graduation as the last chapter in your education, but as the beginning of a new chapter in your life in which you continue to learn and teach others. A humble person is never too wise to learn. A proud person is always too smart to learn. Be a wise, humble learner and a teacher. Second point is to live. Where should we live? I would like to tell you this evening, I think we need to learn to live in the present. Time is a gift, and that's why it's called the present. Your presence in the present is a gift to yourself and to those around you. Technology has made it quite easy to be present in body, but not in mind. Technology makes a great servant, but a poor master. As a young person, I look forward with eager anticipation to each birthday. I always enjoy being able to say that I was a year older. I especially long for my 16th, and then my 18th birthday, and then my 21st birthday. For those birthdays bring various privileges and freedoms that you don't experience before that time. Now that those years are a long time in the past, I view birthdays a little differently than I did. While I still enjoy them, I can more easily wait for them to arrive than I could 30 years ago. I want to encourage all of us to live in the present. As much as possible, enjoy each stage of life. I can tell you from experience that making the best of each day as it comes is much preferred to trying to live in the future or in the past. There are enjoyable times in every stage of life if we slow down enough to appreciate the present. The second thing, you need to learn to live with purpose. A wise man once said, whatever your hands find to do, do it with all your might. You can meander through life and do things half-heartedly, or you can decide that if something is worth doing, you might as well do it to the best of your ability. I believe life will be much more enjoyable when you live it with zest, finding purpose in the tasks that need to be done. A good thing to realize right when you're young is that life is made up of ordinary tasks, or most of life is made up of ordinary tasks. So So it's up to you to decide what your attitude will be as you conquer these ordinary tasks. Do them with excellence, and you will be blessed. And you will also bless those around you who will notice your good attitude. Attack life with a purpose and a burning desire to honor God in whatever your hands find to do. And the last point, I would like to encourage you to plan. What should you plan for? I think the first thing you need to plan for is the future. And as you plan for the future, leave room for detours. One day last week, I had a job that was about an hour away. And I had told the customer that I would show up at a certain time. And I was traveling there in my dump truck and my trailer, just enjoying the scenery. And I was on time. I was getting close to the job, maybe 15 minutes away. And all of a sudden, I came to a sign that said, road closed. And there was a detour, but by the time I came to the detour, I couldn't stop and make the turn anymore. So I had to take another detour, and it ended up taking me an extra 15 minutes that I hadn't anticipated spending to drive to the job. Now, I had a choice to make during that time. I could sit in my truck and stew about this detour, or I could enjoy the scenery along the path. Well, I will tell you, I stewed a little bit about it. But by the end of the detour, I was enjoying the scenery. You know what? That's life. That happens on the road of life as well. And when it does, you need to make a choice. You can either get bent out of shape, or you can make the most out of a bad situation. It's up to you. But I would encourage you, enjoy the scenery along the new and different route. Up to this point, you have followed a familiar path for most people that are your age by attending kindergarten through 12th grade and now graduating. Now, though, you will probably have much more input in the direction that you travel from here. I would encourage you to consider carefully where that will be. And in your consideration, remember that you are probably not the first person that has traveled this way. It is wise to ask experienced travelers for input on your journey. Proverbs 15 tells us that without consultation and wise advice, plans are frustrated. But with many counselors, they are established and succeed. In conclusion, I want to encourage you, learn from the past, live with purpose in the present, and make wise plans for the future. A well-planned, secure future will always include making plans for eternity, because God has created and placed with each one of us a spirit and a soul that will live forever. God also has a plan for your life. Including God in your plans now will guarantee your future for eternity and give you hope in the present. And I want to close by reciting a poem that I learned from one of my Bible school teachers many years ago. But it's a poem that I have recited now and again, and I think it's fitting to recite it tonight. I want one ship drives east and the other west with the self same winds that blow. 'Tis the set of the sail and not the gale that decides the way to go. Like the winds of the sea are the waves of faith as we journey along through life. 'Tis the set of the soul that decides the goal and not the calm or the strife. May God bless you.
Thank you, Matt. This is the point you guys have been waiting for what, 13 years maybe? So, class of 2022, would you stand please? I'd like to invite Michael Beachy, Chairman of the Board, to join us, as well as Macy Chupp, to as we present the diplomas and the roses. Okay, Joshua Allen Beachy. Mackenzie Renell Slaybaugh. Jonathan Dominic Schrock. Thank you. Yoder. Okay, thank you. May I be seated? All right, I'll invite Dave Yoder to come forward. He's the father of Jordan Yoder, one of the graduates, for the dedication prayer.
Writer of Proverbs said, commit your works to the Lord and he will establish your ways. That's much what Matt was saying. And as we pray a dedication prayer, that is amplified when you establish or when you are committing your works to the Lord. So let's pray. Father, tonight we are aware of your presence here and we thank you for it. Thank you for these graduates that are celebrating their last year of high school. We especially pray a dedication, and we dedicate them to you. We dedicate Josh to you. We dedicate Mackenzie to you. We dedicate Jonathan to you, and we dedicate Jordan to you. May your hand of blessing rest on them, and may they commit their works to you, and may you establish their ways. We give them to you, Father, and we call them your children, your sons and daughters. We thank you, and we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I'd like to invite the graduating class of 2022 to stand, if you would. Right. And I present to you, graduating class of 2022. Each of us as we go from here, pray your special blessing on the food, Lord, that has been provided, and our fellowship together afterwards, Lord. And Lord, especially, just thank you for the class of 2022 as they move on, Lord, and just thank you for what they mean to me, Lord, through over the years, and as they go from here, Lord, just pray that you will guide and direct them. And we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Okay, you may be seated, and the ushers will direct you here shortly in terms of the food and kind of usher you through the food line. There'll be two rows of chairs here. They'll remove to kind of create a place for an aisle there close to the food table. So they will direct those of you in those rows accordingly. So you can relax and chat while the food is being prepared and getting ready to serve it. So thank you.